Thank you for staying with us. It's 2 Plus Politics. Now, Abdullahi Ganduje, the governor of Kano State, has been awarded, have you heard, the best governor to have performed brilliantly in the first 100 days in office, in case you didn't hear me. Yes, that is true. Now, this award was conferred by the African Group of Democrats under the aegis of African Democracy Assessment Network, ADAN, based in Dakar, Senegal. So, we'll be talking about the governor and his 100 days in office. I still have in the studio Tunji Abdulhamid, lawyer, political analyst, and Ada Njemanzi, PR expert. I'll start with you, Ada. So this group, I've never heard of them, by the way, have decided to pick one of the most controversial governors who we all saw videos and, you know, by the way, because, you know, if the EFCC is asked why he's not been investigated, they say, oh, well, he has immunity and he's still a sitting governor. That's another issue. But 100 days in office, he's been awarded as one of the best performing governors in Nigeria. How do you take that message, first things first?
When I saw it, I said, based on.
Yes.
It's 100 days in the office. I mean, we're not saying you need to boast about what you've been doing. But there are certain actions that you see beyond, you don't even need to read about it. The people in the state can start telling you all about what their governor has done. And we haven't seen that. So I'm wondering, is it the free education? Is it the, because you know, he has the free education and he's provided, they've worked on over 1,000 schools to provide free education for primary and secondary education. But I'm not, 100 days? Are we celebrating 100 days? Are we celebrating the first tenure? I mean, I'm confused because that was my question.
But this is not new in Nigeria. In fact, it's not just in Nigeria. I mean, even in the US, there's this 100 days in office thing. I mean, for Trump, everybody was hoping that, you know, and then he had signed some executive orders, you know, for his first 100 days. It's an assessment, but the thing is, are we to celebrate it?
I really don't understand the 100 days in office. Worldwide, I really don't. It's a personal thing. Because I feel 100 days out of how many days left in your tenure, 100 days, we can easily say somebody achieved something in a month. Mm-hmm. But what does that say about the tenure? We're celebrating a governor right now, a new governor, and the governor that we're celebrating right now, he's done so much in the 100 days, and then some people are saying, I hope he keeps it up. You understand? So 100 days for me is too little to say, oh, we're celebrating this. There are some states that were so damaged that even in the first 4 years, it's going to be difficult to work on that. Yes, to commend a governor who has done good, wonderful.
So commendations can also be awards.
Yes, you know? But 100 days? What is 100 days?
Now, I'd just like to go into some of the things that the group made reference to. Now, they said, why the Kano State governor was the first pick for the 100 days in office was because he had his intention to establish a college of education. Intention, please, let's underline that word. To establish a college of education, that's a technical college of education, for women, was considered by that panel of research as a genuine policy pronouncement. It's not being done, by the way. This was, and they said this will also go a long way in boosting girl child education in the state. That's one. Now, they also said that he made a clear pronouncement that both basic and secondary education will be free and compulsory. And they were also amazed that his policy pronouncement on free and compulsory basic secondary education became a reality. So this is one of the reasons why he was the first pick. Let's take a look at that.
I think, I want to agree with her that it's too short for anybody to assess anybody within 100 days, particularly our governors. And I am also confused that what they are assessing, where they've said it now, the award was given based on an intention to do this, which has not been done.
And a pronouncement, and which they say has become intention. A reality.
I recently have not been to Kano. I've not seen especially in the last 100 days, I've not been there, so I don't know what and what he has put in place. And they've not told us what and what he has put in place. What they all just told us here is that he had an intention to do this, which they consider as great. If we are looking at intention, I think Sheyi Makinde of the governor of excellency, the governor of your state, should be the number one governor as far as I'm concerned. Because apart from intention that our policies he has shown, he has also shown the capacity, or he has shown the desire to improve the state. He has done a lot regarding education. He has done so he has taken certain steps.
But they're also saying that, look, the man's pronouncement on free and compulsory basic education has become a reality.
That means they are looking at the previous, what he has done in the last 4 years, not 100 days.
That's what
because
I was saying.
Because that pronouncement was done, and exactly. The reality, because it's not just because he started it just in the 100 day. He has started before now. And then, I don't even understand this group. I tried to Google and look for them on whatever. I couldn't find them. Seriously speaking, I don't know. I have tried to Google their name to see who and who they are, what are their antecedents, who are the people behind it, this and that. I have not seen anything. I cannot even get any information regarding them. So, and I believe, though, these days, awards are in Nigeria is with money. Once you can pay, you can get award.
I've been
offered awards whereby what they do these days is that they will give you that letter of nomination that they will say for you. However, this award will be confirmed on you provided you can do this. In other words, they will now put a list of certain things there. They will say this is for 500,000, this is for this and that. So once you can pay that money, you get the award.
So it's no longer by merit.
Sometimes it's not by merit. Sometimes.
But again, you said you disagree with the whole idea of, you know, celebrating 100 days in office. Could it also be that these things were fueled by us and that we somewhat have become so mediocre that we don't, you know, wait for certain things to come to fruition before we start rolling out the drums and applauding? Because I spoke about this last week and I was saying, everybody's talking about 100 days in office and, you know, Sheyi Makinde and all of that. Why don't we watch? Because there are people who start out great, and at the end of the day, everything becomes, you know, to a crumbling stop.
I mean, did we start the 100 days in office? Is it a Nigerian thing?
Because I know did we go along with it?
Yeah, because I think we're just going along with it. But this is the thing. I tell people that when we try to copy some of the more developed countries, look at the years, look at the effort, look at the development that has gone in. We can't afford to start celebrating some of those things right now because we are supposed to be getting to those places. But we're not. We're taking steps back. So I'm looking at it 100 days. You have 4 years to go. You know, let's celebrate you after 4 years. Because in 4 years, how many people have built roads in 100 days? There are some states that have roads that are so terrible. So what are we really...
Let's see. Maybe Governor
Wike. So what are we celebrating exactly? Awarding contracts.
Intention.
You know,
proclamation.
Which there are so many intentions in Nigeria
exactly.
That have not been
done. The former governor of my state, sorry to cut you, the former governor of my state, the contracts that they gave out were too much in most states. You know, he gave out so many contracts for especially with the roads. And the roads started, they started doing well, and everybody was excited. And then guess what? Halfway, everything just stopped. So you move on a nice road, you're like, wow, where is... And then you get to one part, your car just... let me just park my car and just trek the rest. So what are we celebrating? You celebrate... For me, if you see somebody doing something good, you commend the person. Yes, we'll always commend you. But when you have done... to a certain, then we'll be like, this person did fantastic.
I've learned not to celebrate intention in this country again, particularly from our politicians, because they will hide your hope and they'll just bring it down. You know, so Nigeria, I know that we have people with good policies. Subsequent government, they've been giving out policies that are very good to implement that policy are the problem. So if you are awarding somebody, I'll give you somebody an award based on intention, of what he has not done. And there are people on ground who have been doing one or two things. You do not give the award to them. It gives cause to worry.
Okay, well, I want to say thank you to you, Ada, and Chunji, thank you very much. It's been an interesting conversation. We now award intentions. We'll take another break and Bring You Our Plus package. We will be showing a conversation that I had earlier on with Kathleen Ndongmo. She's a public affairs analyst from Cameroon, and she spoke on xenophobia. When I come back, I'll give you my take. Live in the studio is Kathleen Ndongmo. She's a Cameroonian, and we're going to take her thoughts on what's happening in South Africa. Thank you for joining us, Kathleen.
Absolute pleasure.
From the perspective of a person looking outside in, explain to us what you think about what's happening in South Africa, especially the xenophobic attacks.
It's fear. It's just as, you know, an environment that has created fear for anyone who is not South African, mm-hmm. Anyone who is not an indigene. You begin to fear for, you know, your life, your livelihood, your future, you know, the ability of governments protecting Africans who are going from one country or the other in an environment where those same African leaders are signing borderless business and immigration, mm-hmm. you know, documents, or for want of a better word, they are signing these agreements to allow an open Africa. And also it's worrisome for history. It's even more worrisome when you think that this is a country that has come from a history of support from around the continent and around the world. I think it's a failure of leadership. If you ask me, it's an incredibly difficult time for anyone who is either South African or non-South African, because what's going to happen is that if you are South African in another country, then you are seen with the eyes of victims who think that people from your country are coming onto, you know, to attack you as a foreigner. Mm-hmm. And so you're not safe. Just imagine walking as a South African into a shop of a Nigerian in London. The first thing that will be in your head is, how are they going to look at me? Mm-hmm. I look like, you know, a perpetrator of Afrophobia. And I think it's not a good time for Afrophobia to happen on the continent with everything that we're trying to build around the continent. So whether it's foreign investment, whether it is internal business, whether it is trade, whether it's travel, we have over 9 African countries today who have opened their borders. You can land in Rwanda or Ethiopia or in Senegal or in Ghana and get a visa on arrival. And so it makes a lot of, you know, Africans begin to feel that South Africa has become cut away from the continent. And it's strange because it's South Africa, you know. If you take away the Africa, mm-hmm. imagine it becomes South. Mm. So it's very dangerous what's going on there now.
There have been people who have blamed the government, politicians, you know, for selfish reasons. They have either not allowed the people to be as educated as they should be to understand that this is an evil of sorts. And there are also people who are saying that those who know that these people are ignorant take advantage of it for political reasons. And this, whether we like it or not, politicians make up the government. What do you think the South African government should be doing instead of trying to play defensive? What should they be doing at this point? Because Zambia has grounded all flights mm-hmm. coming to South Africa or coming from South Africa into their country, and Tanzania and other countries are doing the same, except Absolutely. For Nigeria. So what do you think that the South African government should be prioritizing right now?
I think the ANC has been in power for very long and has been in power at a time when South Africa was, you know, undergoing colonial rule, mm-hmm. White rule. And so you would expect that at a time like this, the government will borrow from the experiences of the past and say, hey, this is the time when we need to not only protect residents, but also protect not just the name of the country, but protect the future of leadership and the future of democratic rule in the country. South Africa has a duty to prove that it has learned from its history. And if it doesn't do that, then you would not be blaming any African country that decides to take serious action, you know, against it, whether it's embargoes or trade or restrictions for travel or even business restrictions. I think it's time for the government to not just look at the social services that they are providing to their own citizens, but also every single issue on the socio-political realm, whether it's education, whether it's employment, which, I mean, some people have complained about, whether it's just providing social safety catch nets, school, hospitals, and every other thing that is considered a basic for human beings to live or growing the economy. It's time for South Africa to address their own internal socio-political issues.
Well, it's time for my take. So, Governor Abdullahi Ganduje is being awarded the best performing governor after 100 days in office. Interesting. And the underlining statement was that he was awarded based on his intention to do certain things, especially in terms of education, girl child education, intentions. I'm beginning to think that we're no longer serious with governance in this country, and we're no longer serious with holding those people who supposedly is to lead us to get good governance accountable. How do you make a person accountable if you are applauding them for intentions? We have so many good intentions in this country. How many of those intentions have come into fruition? And not to say that certain people do not, you know, need to be applauded, but it's 100 days. We got 4 more years to go, if not 300 and plus days. 3 years, I beg your pardon, and some more months to go. And you're awarding somebody for 100 days. Are we really serious in this country, Nigeria? Do we really like where we are? This mediocre space that we're in? Come on, let's wake up and do something right. Let's no longer keep applauding this mediocrity that we are doing. Let's stop this jamboree politics and get to proper governance. I will keep sounding like a broken record. Stop this. Come on, Nigerians. And again, the police is saying that Muslims can go on a procession, but the Shiites can. So I'm going to ask Mr. Frankumba and the rest of them, who are the Shiites? Are they not Muslims? If you're going to put out a statement, let it be succinct and concise. Let's not cause confusion, and don't be so trigger happy to shoot at people. They're rubber bullets, they're water cannons. Let's police rights so that it doesn't look like you're pencils in the hands of a certain person. I'm Maryann, and it's been Plus Politics.